chairman is exceptional class director of the Centre National de la Recherche Scientifique in France. The competence fields are drug delivery in targeting gene therapy, non-viral gene delivery, in vivo imaging, and main present and recent functions, ongoing creator and director of the Chemical and Genetic Pharmacology Unit with several partners in CERM, CNRS, Pharmacy University, École Nationale Supérieure de Chimie de Paris, is actual president of the Committee of Non-Viral Gene Therapy of the European Society of Cell and Gene Therapy, member of Non-Viral Gene Therapy Committee of the American Society of Gene Therapy, founding bureau member of the Société Française de Thérapie Cellulaire et Génique, an ongoing member of the National Committee of the French Centre National de la Recherche Scientifique. Professor Sherman will talk on genetic pharmacology and gene therapy, the new revolutionary frontiers of innovative medicine. Thank you, Professor.
Thank you for the nice introduction, and I'm delighted to be in such a fantastic place, a temple of culture and science. So I'll try to be concise and present you this some concept into this revolution in medicine. So as you know, classical pharmacology was using small molecules and they were targeting proteins. I'm going to present some new concepts which are based on either small chemical molecules that we call oligonucleotide that bind to RNA or DNA according to the Wasson-Crick code. So this is why we call it genetic pharmacology, because it's a recognition pharmacology based on Wasson-Crick matching. And gene therapy is delivering a gene to a cell. So in gene therapy, you have also cell therapy, which means you can use, and this is the last technology, which is developing very fast. And usually, people can combine cell and gene therapy because we use genetically modified cells. So we have some kind of synergy between gene therapy and cell therapy. So as I mentioned, the first part of my presentation will be about genetic pharmacology. So this technology uses chemical synthetic deoxyribonucleotide or ribonucleotide. Ernst presented already with the siRNA some part of this new genetic pharmacology. And as I mentioned, it uses the Wasson-Crick recognition. So, I mean, all of you know what is Wasson-Crick recognition. I don't have to go into the detail. It's based on base pairing, A in front of T, G in front of C, and this allows to very exquisitely target a defined location on mRNA or on DNA. And you have different ways to go for it. For instance, if you use, this is a drug, a short oligonucleotide. If it binds to DNA here, it will block the production of mRNA. It will play as an antigene. So it can block the production of mRNA. But what you want most of the time is to inhibit the production of a protein. And DNA, mRNA, messenger RNA, protein, if you destroy mRNA, you will stop the production of the protein. So this is what is being used here by an antisense oligonucleotide that binds to mRNA and degrades mRNA. There are other tools, antagonist of mRNA, siRNA. These were presented by Ernst. So first, I will just give you some snapshot of recent progress and result obtained with this revolutionary technology. Spinal muscular atrophy is a rare neuromuscular disorder, dramatic disease, because there is a loss of motor muscle, and you see a dramatic situation of these kids. Actually, the neurons which are affected are the motor neurons which are originating in the spinal here, and life is absolutely horrible, and most of the kids die at the age of two. So now it's possible to have kids nearly having a real life, and this is only during this year that this new drug has been approved. So how does it work? It's all based on what we learned from the molecular biology, from the genome history of this disease. Because this drug is called Spinraza, and it is the first treatment for spinal muscular atrophy. It was approved last year. And the rationale is based on the fact that about 15 years ago, it has been very short, Professor Mergui in France identified that spinal muscular atrophy was originating from a mutation into a gene that she called SMN. SMN means survival of motor neuron. So, I'm sorry, here. And she found that there are two SMN genes, SMN1 and SMN2. SMN1 is producing the correct genes, the correct protein. So survival of motor neurons, the neurons survive, and people are healthy. But there is SMN2. We don't know why there is SMN2, but we have SMN2. And SMN2 is making very little of the correct protein. It makes a lot of truncated protein, which is not active. And people with the disease, they have no more SMN1. So they don't produce the survival factor. So the trick, the strategy was, can we force SMN2 not to make this truncated protein, but to make a healthy factor, normal protein? And this is exactly what the drug does, because this is a scheme of the gene of SMN2, and this is what we call exon. This is what gives the protein, and in red is intron. And because here you have this intron in the messenger RNA, this cannot go to the end, and this cannot make a regular protein because you have some kind of mismatch here. So actually the drug is essentially targeting this domain, binding here, and making the normal processing of the protein to occur. So now, with this drug, SMN2 is leading to a correct protein. So they are delivering this small oligonucleotide in the spinal cord, intrathecal delivery, and it works surprisingly well. And after 3 months of the first result, the FDA gave the approval, and they stopped to make the control placebo because it was so evident that the drug was working that even the placebo group were treated with the drug. So it's some kind of miracle of this new technology. Now I shift to a second arm of this. It's gene therapy. So gene therapy means you introduce DNA, not a small chemical oligonucleotide, but you introduce a gene, which means a promoter, a gene sequence, a poly-A termination of transcription. And this contains a function that can correct deletion. If a gene is not efficient, you just deliver the regular, proper, healthy gene into the cells. But the beauty of it is that we found that gene therapy can help us to cure not only genetic disease, to correct genetic disorder, but also any kind of other disease can potentially be cured by delivering a gene to treat a patient. Why? Because, for instance, some diseases are treated by protein. You administer a protein, and when you administer a protein, you see, this is visible here, it goes, maybe this can work. No. The protein concentration in the blood goes up, it can go very, very far up and be toxic, and then it goes down, for instance, for hemophilia, and people are not protected. And then you have to administer again, and again, and again. With gene therapy, ideally, you can have the tissue to produce the protein on a constant matter. So actually, for instance, for hemophilia, blood clotting factor 9 or 8 are absent, If you use proteotherapy, you have time where there is too much clotting factor, you have a risk of clotting accident. There are times where there is not enough clotting factor, you have many, the patient have many microhemorrhages, and they have terrific inflammation in their knee, in their joint. Ideally, with gene therapy, they would have a constant production of factor by any organ, muscle or liver. Now, the question is, how can we deliver DNA into a cell? How can we deliver a gene? So most of what has been used so far for gene therapy, I would say 90% of the development of the technology, is based on using virus, because viruses are natural truck to deliver their genes into the cell and to invite the cell. The virus is not a living organism. It uses the power of a cell, but in order to replicate, to multiply itself, it delivers its genetic material into the cells. So it's a natural vector for delivering a gene. And four types of viruses have been mainly used. retrovirus, which is normally a cancer giving inducing virus. Lentivirus, like HIV. Adenovirus, and adeno-associated virus, which is a virus associated to adenovirus, and adenovirus is the flu virus. So it's very surprising, because the two which are the more successful and which are used now in most of the trials are lentivirus and adeno-associated virus. And HIV, which is a terrible disease, is now used for mankind, and is now one of the best vectors for treat disease like cancer. So it's very funny, because this terrific disease has been reversed and used by human science and technology actually to be an incredible, wonderful tool to treat people. So basically, how do we make these viruses? I will not go into the detail, but what we do is that we introduce DNA into a cell which has been engineered to produce viruses. And all this is molecular biology, technology. Actually, the viruses that is produced is not pathologic viruses, it is a deficient viruses which cannot replicate itself. It's only a cargo where the therapeutic genes have been inserted into the virus. So it's essentially a shuttle to deliver the genes that you want to deliver. So this is how it does. It binds to the cell membrane exactly like Ernst presented, and it delivers very naturally the therapeutic genes into the cell. Another type of gene therapy doesn't use virus. And Ernst and me, we are more involved into this, and we use the plasmid DNA, which are a small circular DNA that can be produced very cheap and in very large quantity into by bacteria. And it can be introduced into the cells by chemical vector, cationic lipid, cationic polymer. Ernst presented you this field earlier. And also electric pulses. And it is a multidisciplinary domain, because you need concept of biology, chemistry, physicochemistry, material sciences. So electroporation is the second big arm to deliver this gene. How does it work? You can use it in vivo or in vitro on isolated cells. So what you do is you introduce the plasmid, and you deliver very short pulses, 20 milliseconds. Normally the treatment is terminated after less than 1 second. And the optimized pulses that we discovered are able to open the membrane of the cell, and by an electrophoretic movement, because DNA is an anionic molecule, so there is an electric field, so the field will draw DNA, it is a charged molecule. This electrophoresis will draw DNA into the nucleus, and it works wonderfully actually in muscle in vivo and in vitro on cells. So there are two ways to perform gene therapy. One is in vivo gene therapy. You deliver directly DNA with a delivery technique into a human. I will give you some examples. So this is an AAV, which is delivered into a man. And one company, Spark Therapeutics, is actually using some early research of no more than 10 years old, maybe 15, on AAV, and you see, this is absolutely incredible because they have no one product which has been this year accepted to treat people with PRRPE65 mutation. So RPE is codes for retinal pigmental epithelium, which means these kids, they have a mutation in protein, 65 kilodalton protein in retinal, in their retinal pigmental cells, and they are blind. So what they are doing is that injecting subretinally in the retina, they make a blob, so the retina is taken a little bit by a distance from the rest of the eye, and they inject AAV coding for the gene RPE65, and it works. The kids, they were blind, they began to see again, and the drug has been approved on the market this year. This is very exciting news. Now, the second application I would like to mention is hemophilia B. So you see they are in phase 1-2 of this. So what do? They just make a drug, which is adeno AAV with a gene coding for factor 9. Of course, I make it very very short and simple, but it was not so complicated. It was quite complicated. You have to optimize the production. You have to fight against the immune response, against the transgene. But at the end of the day, after 10 years of hard work by controlling the immune reaction against the transgene and against the virus, this is how it goes. You deliver AAV by intravenous administration, no pain, very simple, one treatment. Virus goes to the liver because there are many different AAV, but the one they chose is the one that has a preference for the liver. And then they look to the expression of factor 9 into the blood of this patient. And you see that after 2 months, they have about 40% of normal level, which is more than enough, because with 5% of normal factor 9, you are cured, basically. So now they have 2 years, maybe even 3 years, and the patients are out of treatment. They don't need any clotting protein anymore. It is stable, and it's very stable. And I think that in the next few years, hemophilia B will be treated. Hemophilia A is another problem because it is a large gene and it's difficult because it is too large to be encapsulated into an AAV, but they are making tricks by splitting the gene in two, delivering two AAV and making the cell to link the two different parts of the gene so that people, and I've seen, I was in Berlin last week in a European gene therapy meeting and it seems to work, which means we have good hope to treat as well hemophilia A, which is the most frequent link to deficiency in factor 8. Okay, one thing I was involved was to discover how we can deliver plasmid DNA into muscle, and the patent was licensed to an American company, Inovio, which is now in phase 3, to develop a therapeutic vaccine to treat cancer, cervical dysplasia, which is a high-grade squamous intraepithelial lesion caused by human papillomavirus. And this human papillomavirus is the cause of most of the cases of cancer of the cervix in women, and in men, it's the cause of most largest cause of cancer, head and neck carcinoma, in young men contaminated by women partners. So it's a real problem, and when they are chronically infected, there is no cure for that. So what they are developing is what they call therapeutic immunotherapy, which means you make a vaccine so strong that you are able even to fight against a chronic virus which is already in your body. And they are trying also to develop this technology for chronically infected people with hepatitis A and B viruses. So the immune response we get with electroporation in muscle by producing proteins from the virus in the muscle is so strong, and the immune system is so much involved and making so violent that it's able to overcome the defense and to destroy the chronically infected cells. So it's a big hope, and we are waiting for the result of phase 3. Another application I'm working with an Australian team is what we call a bionic ear, and I will just present the concept. It's incredible. I think people will like it because it's a mix of technology. You know, some people, they have no more hairy cell in the cochlea. Cochlea is what you have in your ear, and is responsible for hearing. And for very deep loss of hearing, dumb people, genetically dumb people, the hairy cells are destroyed. So what do they do? It's an incredible technology. They have here some kind of receptor that takes the sound, transform it by Fourier transformation, and then it's linked to the cochlea. And here you have a set of microelectrodes that are linked to this receptor, and each one of these electrodes is excited by a different frequency. So you reconstitute the sound in the cochlea by reconstituting 18 different frequencies, which are computed by the computer they have under their skin and their head. So about 1 million people are now wearing this kind of bionic ear. The problem is that this is the electrode here, all this stimulating electrode. But the problem is that with these people, you see, you have hairy cells here. There are no more hairy cells. So the spiral nerve that conducts the sound to the brain is degenerated. So in spite of the fact that you have these bionic electrodes here, they are quite far from the nerve, and it doesn't work so well. So the reconstruction of the sound is not good enough, and if there are two people talking together, they are not able to understand in a conversation. So what we are doing with Gary Housley in Sydney is using this microelectrode to deliver, by the electrotransfer technique I have presented to you, some DNA here. And this DNA is coding for what we call the trophic factor, a neurotrophic factor, which is a factor that makes the nerve grow again. And it works. I don't have the time to show you the data, but we see dramatic reconstruction of the nerve that will go up to here and go near the vicinity of the electrode. So we hope to, we are now in the cat experiment, and if we, next week we'll have the result. If we have an increase in the hearing of these cats, next year we are in human with this technology. Ex vivo gene therapy, and this will be my two last examples, is another paradigm. You take some cells of the patient, potentially stem cells, and you transform them to give them some good property, and then you reintroduce them into the patient. So this is something we are involved in. I will make it very short. You know that age-related macular degeneration is a more important, highest cause of visual loss in people over 60, because there is a degeneration of the macula, central portion of the retina. About 30% are wet AMD, and this wet AMD is caused by neovascularization, which means blood vessels are growing on the retina and covering the retina, and people get blind. So there are some treatments actually on the market. People get injections into their eye of anti-angiogenic factors that blocks growth of new vessels. Namely, you have soluble VEGF receptor or anti-VEGF therapy, because VEGF, vascular endothelial growth factor, is a factor for making a vessel grow. What we are doing now in our trial is we take some cells from the iris, we transform them by electroporation, we deliver a gene which is called PEDF, pigmental epithelial derived factor, and this gene is very, very potent anti-angiogenic. It blocks the growth of any vessels. And we found on animals that when we reintroduce these cells in the retina near the macula, there is a complete stop of vascularization. So now in the process of making all the clinical trial, which means GMP production of plasmid, GMP device for electroporation, and normally next year we will treat our first patient with this technology by reintroducing on the retina some cells that will continuously produce factor which blocks neoangiogenesis, and of course, if we do that, it's because we have very positive results on animal experiment. So my last example will be on a genetic modification of T cells with chimeric antigen receptor using PIFAR mini plasmid electroporation. Actually, the chimeric antigen receptor is the largest hype in gene therapy. For 20 years, my friend Zelig Eschar in Weizmann Institute in Technion was, Weizmann Institute was working alone on this strategy, trying to make immune cells some kind of rockets directed against tumor cells. And it was very efficient in animals, but people thought it would never work in humans. But some American team in Philadelphia found a way to improve the response to this strategy. And now it is an incredible result that I'm going to present to you. And just to mention you the value of this technology, one of these companies, Kite Pharmaceuticals, which was created 4 years ago by the patent of Zelig Eschar, was created in Israel and then it went to America, was bought by Gilead Pharmaceutical 3 months ago for $12 billion. So you see the value of these things and how it goes for in this kind of technology. So how does it work? I will make it very simple. This is here a tumor cell, very bad tumor cells. And here is a lymphocyte. And some lymphocytes are cytotoxic. They kill other cells. The problem is that to kill other cells, they use what they call a T cell receptor, because this lymphocyte is a T cell. We call it T cell, T lymphocyte. And the cancer cell, they have learned to neutralize this recognition of the T cell receptor. So what Zelig has introduced is just some kind of molecular engineering. He took one piece of DNA that codes for pieces of antibody, and it was presented by Ernst. It's a little piece of antibody that binds to a protein present on the tumor cell. And then he linked that by DNA technology to a transmembrane potential, and here he linked that to signaling peptide, which are important for T cell to become active, to multiply, and to become very active killer. So it's, you know, it's little to say that this, to be able to think about, to do that, you need a lot of basic knowledge on what are the proteins expressed by tumor cells, but also how these T lymphocytes work, how they are activated. You need a complete understanding on the activation transduction signal of these T lymphocytes. So you need basic immunology. But once you have this basic immunology, you can design this kind of tool. And actually, it's very simple. You take some, you mobilize some T cells from the blood of the patient by giving some drug. You treat the cells either by the lentivirus, because now the most potent technology is using this HIV lentivirus, as I told you. We use plasmid and electroporation, and we might be clinical for multiple myeloma next year with the German team. But actually, the most advanced people are using lenti or retroviruses, which are very difficult to produce and very expensive. And you just introduce the cell back into the patient, and the T cell will multiply because there are a lot of tumor. And they just injected that into some people. So the first was done at the University of Penn in Pennsylvania in people affected with acute lymphoblastic leukemia, which is a disease, which is a cancer of white blood cells. Actually, the blood of these people were blood, were white. They had no more red cells because they were completely invaded by white cells. And these white cells overproduce and accumulate. And this, I mean, actually, the patients were on complete relapse from previous treatment. There were no hope. There were 3 months hope of survival. And they injected this lymphovirus, T lymphocyte modified by a lymphovirus. Very big reaction, some kind of what we call cytokine storm, because there is a lot of things happening in the patient. But now they know how to control this cytokine storm. And after 3 weeks, nearly the tumor was disappearing, and it's complete response, 90% of complete response. And the people are now for 2 years 80% are still surviving. So now more than about 1,000 patients have been treated. And Novartis, which was the first to buy this technology from Penn, received the first FDA approval for CAR T-cell. They call it Kymriah. It's for children and young adults with BCL, acute lymphoblastic leukemia, which has been refractory to other treatment. Nearly 3 months after, Kite Pharmaceuticals, which, as I told you, was bought for $12 billion by Gilead, had also its approval by the same kind of CAR T-cell, we call it Yescarta. It's for treatment of adult patients with refractory lymphoma, and now they are working in non-Hodgkin lymphoma, which is a huge class of blood tumor. And just to mention that this is a very complex technology, this is a book I published last year at Imperial College Press on gene therapy and genetic pharmacology principle, and you see this is a very complex field. You have the definition, the principle, the vectors, viral, non-viral, therapeutic application, you find them everywhere now. It's an incredible field. I think we are really on the eve of a Copernicus revolution in terms of medical treatment. So my conclusion would be that we do see actually, we do not see any limits to these new therapeutic strategies. They are absolutely flabbergasting. There is a real accelerated transfer from basic research to medical application. Quite fast access to approved drug medicines, 3 to 4 years, this is exceptional, because there are real needs, of course. The problem is the cost of treatment, because some of these treatments are between $500,000 to $1 million per dose. This is why we go for plasmid DNA, but they obtain from the authority this kind of price, because they said it's one treatment, and if you calculate the cost of a kid with a spinal muscular atrophy, just to maintain the kid under constant respiration and so on, it can be $300,000 a year or $400,000 a year. With this cure, you treat. So this is how they calculate the cost. And one dose, one treatment, as I mentioned. And of course, this opens the way to tissue repair, modification of tissue, of course. I said this is, there is not only gene therapy, there are other very active fields now, all based on capacity to manipulate cells. So cell therapy for tissue repair, tissue regeneration, bioelectronic interfaces for vision, hearing disorder, prosthesis. We are really facing a fascinating period of medicine, and thank you for your attention.
Time and for your very, very interesting talk.
Thank you.
We feel more happy with the promise of all these technologies you have communicated us. So thank you.
Thank
we
you.
Have time for a few questions, please.
Thank you. Professor Sherman, you did a fantastic work. I've been following what you're doing over the last 20 years, and it's very pleasing to see that you're getting somewhere. So I'm really impressed by that. I have a question on your electroporation. Electroporation actually induces a membrane, cell membrane rupture, and then you need simultaneously, not necessarily at the same place, but you also have to rupture the nucleus membrane, right? So my question is, during the electroporation, everything can get into the cell, and in particular, how the cell responds to osmotic pressure, for example?
Actually, this is a very good question. I mean, the way it works, why it is successful is because, you know, this lasts less than 1 millisecond. So there is entry of some other compound and some ATP is leaking out of the cells, but membrane reparation is very, very fast and the cells survive. So this is the point. Osmotic pressure, Well, I mean, if you open the cells, I don't think there is any osmotic factor involved there, because we don't. But I mean, it could be interesting, maybe. Maybe your question is, what if we put under osmotic level? Maybe it would be easier to electroporate it.
Right.
That's a possibility.
But also, if you use a polyethylenamine, for example, or any polycationic polymer, they are not naked. They will come with water because these are salts. So then when you reclose the membrane, the osmotic pressure inside the cell should be very much varied, which could lead to the death of the cell.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure I understood the point. You mean with polymer?
Polyethylamine that you
maybe
inject.
Maybe you can answer the question.
And then you have a polycation,
yeah,
which is accompanied by, this is without reaction, but phosphate, which allows you to do the transfection. These species are highly hydrated.
Okay.
So when you open the membrane, otherwise the membrane will select.
No, but I have to correct you. We perform electroporation with naked DNA. There is no cationic lipid, it's only DNA. So there are two complete technologies. You have the chemical vector on one side, and you have no chemical electroporation on the other side, physics and chemistry.
So no transfection with...
No transfection with vector, only transfection with the plasmid DNA, which makes it so simple. Thank you for the point.
Thank you.